Hello and welcome back to the next video. Today we're going to look at the effect of controls in flight. The fundamentals we are covering apply to every single aircraft that takes flight. Once you understand these fundamentals, you can look at almost any aircraft and explain what any given control surface is doing and why. Let's begin by taking off from Welshpool. The weather this afternoon is suitable for some basic training. Tune the radio to the Welshpool radio frequency and let's make the appropriate calls as we depart. We also might hear another aircraft on the frequency as they are using the same space in this controlled zone. Now that we are in the air and in our assigned training zone, we can begin our basic maneuvers. Control surfaces. Starting from a straight and level attitude, we can see that pushing and pulling the yoke will produce an up and down movement. This is changing the pitch of the aircraft depending on how much we push or pull the yoke. Note that when we return the yoke to a central position, the nose of the aircraft does not return to its original position. We will have to apply pressure on the yoke again in the desired direction to return the nose to the original level attitude. This fact is true for the other two control surfaces as well. Let's have a look at the aileron control. And let's have a look at the rudder control. Now these are the primary effects, but each control surface brings a secondary effect with it. Let's look at these briefly. When applying aileron input, you also get a secondary effect where the aircraft will yaw in the opposite direction that you are banking towards. This is caused by induced drag. Let's look at an example. You are banking left. The right aileron moves down to push the right wing upwards, rolling the plane to the left. But the right aileron is causing induced drag, which loads more drag onto the right wing than on the left. Now, one side of the aircraft is experiencing more drag than the other, and this is why the aircraft yaws in the opposite direction to your turn. The rudder has a secondary effect as well. When using the rudder, you will notice that it produces a rolling motion, even without you touching the aileron controls. The aircraft will roll in the direction of the yaw, because as you yaw, you are pushing one wing forwards and causing it to fly faster through the air than the other. This creates greater lift on the outward wing of the yaw, which causes the outward wing to rise and to bank the aircraft. The effect of differing airspeed. Without altering your power setting, let's reduce our airspeed by pitching the aircraft into a nose-up attitude. As the aircraft bleeds speed, you will begin to notice a difference in the characteristics of the three flight control surfaces. They will be less effective and larger control movements are needed. The opposite can be said for increasing your airspeed. As your speed increases, your control surfaces will be more sensitive and less input should be needed. The effect of propeller slipstream. The slipstream from your propeller creates pressure on certain control surfaces. They are the rudder and elevators. If our throttle is full forward, we will benefit from the maximum pressure of the air flowing over those control surfaces. Those controls will feel nice and responsive. With the power set to idle, you should feel a slight decrease in the responsiveness of the rudder and elevators accordingly. Note that the ailerons will not be affected in any way by this, because their surfaces are outside the influence of the propeller slipstream. The effect of differing power settings. We are flying with cruise power set and trimmed for straight and level flight. In this configuration, it is almost a hands-off situation. If we add extra power without touching anything else, the aircraft should pitch up and yaw to the left. If the power is reduced, the aircraft should nose down and yaw to the right. The yawing motion is due to the engine torque, and the nose moving up and down is due to the fact that with the power change, the aircraft gains or loses lift. The effect of flaps. Flaps essentially provide greater lift to the wings. They temporarily extend the wing's area and create a greater difference of pressure between the underside and the top side of the wing surface. This will mean you can fly safely at a lower speed with extended flaps. These are generally used in the landing phase. The effect of elevator trim. The effect of elevator trim is very similar to the elevator itself. To begin with, the trim might seem a little confusing, but once understood, it will be your friend for the rest of your flying days. There is a small trim tab on the back of the elevators. This is the small control surface that's attached to your trim wheel in the cockpit. When you move that up or down, you are fine-tuning the aircraft's pitch. This means that when in a long cruise, you can fine-tune your aircraft's pitch so that you do not constantly have to be putting pressure onto your yoke. Larger aircraft usually have a trim control for all three control axes. This can be helpful if in a multi-engined aircraft, an engine stops. In that situation, you could trim out the adverse effects of having an unbalanced thrust vector. Spend some time playing around with your aircraft controls. This will help you further down the line as we begin dealing with more complex situations. Your knowledge and muscle memory of your controls is key to mastering the art of flight. Our next video will be on taxiing and the associated taxi signs and runway markings you should be aware of when moving around the airfield. This is incredibly important when you are moving with other aircraft in the area. Thanks for watching, and I will catch you next time.